Amen. All right. Well, this is so far out of my comfort zone, but I'm just going to be obedient to what the Lord is speaking to me and hope that it blesses you. But Jeremiah's little story about Lydia shows you that she's not always smiling. She does throw fits, and they're pretty big ones. But he's right. I'm right in the throes of mothering. That's what I do. I am a stay-at-home mom. I help with the church, the background. I like to be in the background. I like administration. I would prefer it that way. But when the Lord says to speak, I have to be faithful to that and deliver what he has for me to speak. So I'd like to start in prayer. I know you just prayed, but if everybody can just close their eyes again, I just want to welcome the Lord. God, we just thank you for what you want to do here. Lord, I just release your love in this room. God, I just pray that you surround this room and fill it. We welcome you here. We know that you are already here, God. And we ask that you will take hold of our hearts. And if it's just one thing that you can grip our hearts to work on, that you would do it. You're faithful to move, to convict, to just strengthen our hearts this morning. And we ask that you would do it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. So this is the time of the year that you're talking about love. This week, you're probably going to go out on a date if you want to, or your mom's going to buy you a box of chocolates. I'm older. My mom still buys me a present for Valentine's Day, so that's awesome. And then now she buys my kids stuff, too. Her love language is gifts. But usually by the end of February, everyone kind of goes back to their old selves. They go on with life as usual, and the joy kind of leaves. And that just breaks my heart. But this morning, I don't want to talk to you about finding true love, that one person that you're looking for. This morning, I want to talk to you about God, who is love himself. So a lot of this might not even be about relationships, but we are going to build a foundation of what it means to love, why we can love, and how we can love. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. John 3:16. We know that verse. We quote it. We say it and say it and say it. But what does that really mean for us? Before the foundation of the earth, God loved you enough to send his Son. And he sent his Son to die on the cross. And while he was there, he was thinking of you. And he was thinking of you, and he was thinking of you, and he was thinking of me. He loved us enough to give us his love, to be able to love other people. I would not be able to love my husband well if I didn't have God inside of me. It was a setup for us to love him, but we would not be able to love without his love. I can't love my children well without God's love. I don't know how people do it. Because in our strength, we're nothing. But in our weakness, he is made strong. And that's the beauty of who he is and who he is in us. Before I truly knew the Lord, I was so lost. I was a teenage girl trying to find her way. And goodness, I am not really looking forward to when Bella Grace is a teenage girl. So just think back to when I was a teenage girl, and I'm like, oh Lord, Jeremiah, you're gonna have to take over in those years. I'm not sure what I'm gonna do. But I was so lost. But then God met me right where I was. I was 15, and he breathed life into me, and he took me on a journey. I went to Argentina. My dad was a missions pastor, and I went there for reasons for me. Worldly love. We do things for us. It was going to make me feel good. I was going to love on some children because I loved children. That was my sweet spot. I was going to go blow up balloons and make little balloon animals and just have the time of my life doing something good. Of course, that's good. It was loving, but I was doing it out of the wrong motivation. When I was in this tent meeting, we were singing Jesus Freak. Isn't that that song? Yeah. It was DC Talk or something. Or Audio Adrenaline. I don't know. DC Talk. I was right the first time. I'm really bad at music. So I was just going crazy. Well, I have dark hair and dark skin. So the missionary came over to me and she started praying. And I said, no, 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 not an Argentinian. I'm here with you. She's like, nope, the Lord has a word for you. I said, okay. So she prayed over me, and that was the first time that I ever experienced prophecy. I didn't even really know what that meant. And actually, she didn't say, I'm going to prophesy over you. She started praying over me, and I heard God's voice. It was not Sharon Babcock's voice. It was the Lord speaking to me and saying, I have seen you in your darkest hours. I see you when you cry yourself to sleep every single night. And I love you. And I love you way too much to leave you the way that you are. So I'm going to take you on a journey. Now I was 15, so it was kind of hard to wrap it around my brain. But she gave me four different things to do, and I was faithful and I was obedient because the Lord had spoke to me. And I said, this is the voice of God, because no one knew I cried myself to sleep. My stepmom and my mom knew something was up, but they were a little bit too hesitant to go in and be like, what's up? And I had been through some stuff, but I did not wear my heart on my sleeve. I said, I have hardened my heart. I know the Lord. I'm going to love you, but I'm going to do it in my own strength. And right there, I was captivated by the Lord. And I said, God, you know who I am, and I will serve you from this day forward. So I did those four things. One of those four things was moving schools. I was a sophomore in high school, and I was going to move as a junior in high school. Now, I went from being a homecoming queen my sophomore year to going to a high school that nobody knew me. I ran track. I was a track star. And I went to a bigger high school that if I ran track, I'd probably be a little puny runner. So I didn't run. But that was a big deal in my heart, because no one knew who I was. So I had to know who I was. And the Lord took me on a journey of breathing who I was. So I knew my true identity. It was in Christ and what Christ had made me to be. It wasn't fluff stuff like, oh, you're pretty. Oh, you're nice. Oh, you can say the best things. It was, I created you to be a daughter of mine, and I want you to speak my words. I want you to be faithful. When you see someone who no one else likes in that cafeteria, that's who you're going to sit with. You're not going to go try to sit with those other girls. You're going to meet the people where they are. I made it my mission to find those people who didn't have anybody to talk to in the class and say, hey, my name's Morgan. Now, mind you, I was one of those people too. Those other girls didn't want to talk to me, but it was not who I wanted to be anymore. I wanted the Father to say, this is what I want you to do. I see and I sit with the least of these. I want you to do that. I want you to be my love. I wanted to be set apart. That is where I learned the Word of God. I studied what it meant to be a woman of God. And so I wasn't swayed. Before I got saved, it was so easy to be offended, to think and care about what other people thought of me. But when you know who God thinks that you are and created you to be, you will not waver. I promise you that. When you have a confidence in Him, you don't need a confidence in yourself. You don't need confidence from others. You only need confidence from Him. Fast forward to going to Southeastern, I got to go to a Christian college away at Florida. I got a little nervous about it, but when I came here, I was able to just make a fresh start, make new friends. I wasn't close to my home. And I remember overhearing people say, Morgan Dilley is really nice. Morgan Dilley always smiles. Morgan Dilley would help anyone. And I didn't believe that about myself, but when they said it, I woke up and said, man, this is God. God, you and me can love people. I cannot do that on my own strength. But because you are inside of me, they see you. And I'm able to point people to them. Because y'all, I am weak. I am in the throes of like toddler years. And when they are mean to each other, I get angry. I'm like, why would you do that to them? And the Lord reminds me, you are just like them. It's going to take your teaching them hard issues. If I can encourage some mamas in here that are just like me, get to the heart issues, because that's what matters. My parents loved me. They spoke beautiful things over me, but a lot of it was about the outside. And that's what man looks at, is the outside. But the Lord wants your heart. He wants to hear what your heart is saying. And I'll tell you what, they watch our actions way more than what we say. So I can say, oh, a friend loves it all times. You guys are not being loving. This is not Well, that doesn't sound very loving, Mom, and my five-year-old would be very quick to call that out on me. But when I humble myself and say, oh God, please help me, even preparing for this message, I was reminded, Morgan, you have been doing things in your own strength. You have to rely on my strength to do anything. And as I would ask the kids to do something, they would come up and say, Mom, I'm sorry for da-da-da-da-da. Those apologies mean way more than saying, hey, Israel, you need to go tell your sister sorry for hitting her. When they do it on their own, you know their heart is moved because of God. It's because of God. The actions that we're going to do is going to move us way more than what we say. Google is one of the most beautiful things and one of the roughest things I've ever encountered, because you can plug anything in and say, okay, love, give me 20 scriptures on love and you're going to read them. That's awesome. If you don't know who you are, plug something into Google. Find scriptures for yourself. But once you're learning, hide them in your heart. Know where they are. Eat them, breathe them, sleep on them, devour them, because scripture is alive and active, and it's going to change your heart. It's going to allow you to love people. Jeremiah and I met my freshman year of Southeastern, but both of us were not where we needed to be. Both of us took a journey with the Lord, in the Word, finding out who we are. He had just gone through a rough season with his family. I had been just figuring out who I was. I had to know the Word for myself, and that's what would continue to push me on in my relationship. 1 John 4:7 says, dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Wow, that scripture is a big statement. It's a powerful statement. If you don't have love, you probably don't know God. That's challenging. Everybody can probably quote 1 Corinthians 13. If you can't quote it, you've probably heard it, whether you know it's a scripture or not. It is a perfect example of perfect love. We hear it at weddings, we see it on our walls, but do we practice it? I've challenged myself after studying this, of taking this and devouring 1 Corinthians 13. Perfect love is patient and kind. It doesn't envy, it doesn't boast. It is not proud, it doesn't dishonor others. It's not self-seeking. It's not easily angered, and it keeps no record of wrongs. It protects. This is so important in relationships. Protect. I don't know about you men, but women can be catty. They can say the meanest things, but love protects. We need to protect our sisters in Christ. We need to rise up. We need to be different than everybody else and say, we will protect your heart. You're a woman I can trust because I know you know God. So you know love, and you're going to protect my heart. I can trust in you. Your hope is in God. Your love perseveres, and it never fails. Never. There is an attack on marriages right now like never before. It is sad that the statistics are the same about divorce inside the church as it is out. But we can change that by learning what perfect love is. It's never too late. The only way that we can love is by grace. We are saved by grace. His grace enables us to love. It pushes us forward. Jesus' life that was lived out in the Bible is a perfect representation of what true love looked like. He confronted sin. He did not leave them where they were, but he loved on the sinners. He spoke truth, and he was hospitable to a lot of people. He brought freedom and hope to anyone he walked into contact with. But let's talk about an unhindered love. I was captured by this. God loved people he knew would betray him and deny him. his closest friends. Would you still love and befriend somebody you knew would betray you and allow you to be crucified? Would you still befriend someone who would deny you 3 times and say, I don't really know that person? Jesus did. That's really convicting. Sometimes the people that hurt you the most are the ones who need the most love. We have to love those people. Jesus laid down his life for us so that we may live forever. The least that we can do is love the unloving. It should stir our heart to move forward. The thing I kept hearing the Lord say over and over and over is that love and grace have to be married in this hour. We don't have perfect love. We never will. We're not Jesus. But we continue to make strides toward that. We walk closer to it. We walk closer to it. As a Christian, we should be getting better and better and better and better, because I want to love you more, because his grace is sufficient, because in my weakness, he is made strong. So I continue to run. If I get knocked down and I have a bad day with the kids, I don't say, oh man, I'm not a Christian. I don't know love, God. I don't love God. I don't know God. I say, oh God, I need you. I have to have you, because in my weakness, you're strong. You, it's you, all about you. And tomorrow your mercies are going to be new in the morning. So I'm going to get up and I'm going to pray and I'm going to read 1 Corinthians 13 again and say, God, make me more patient. Toddlers want things and they want it now. And you know what? When I look at them, I think about myself. When I want something, I kind of want it now. But we have to take a breath and say, God, only you can do it. Your mercies are new every morning. So in the same way you receive grace, we have to give and extend grace. When someone is not kind to you, I tell my kids, kill them with kindness. Give them the love of Jesus. It's really hard to be mean to someone who is saying, I love you anyways. I know you did that. And you know what? In marriage, I've been able to see that. Some people have done some really mean things to my husband. They have said some really nasty things, regardless of how nice he is, regardless of the love that he shows. People will fail you. I'm just going to let you know. They're going to fail you. I'm going to fail Jeremiah often. But the beautiful thing is, God will never, ever, ever, ever fail you. His love runs deep. It's wide. It's high. It's low. God loves you. He will never stop. There is nothing that you can do that will separate you from his love. You might stop loving him for a season, but he will never stop loving you. He will chase you down even to the distant days. Thank God for Psalm 139 that I eat and breathe. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. He knows the hairs on my head. He knew me when I was in my mother's womb. Whoa! When he was on that cross, he knew me. He said, I'm going to die on this cross because Morgan needs saved. She's yucky. She's gross without me, but with my grace, I will empower her to love others. I'm nowhere in my notes, so I'm apologizing for that. I don't even know where I'm going with this. But the Lord loves people, or the world. The world loves people for themselves. What can you do for me? I can do for you. Let's exchange it. But God loves you sacrificially. He doesn't care what you can do for him. He says, I love you because of who you are. He loves you just the way that you are. And the last point that I want to make is that there is a block that I see in front of a lot of you. And it's a stumbling block, or it can be a stepping stone. The only difference of how it's used is the way that it's used. What are your stumbling blocks? Can you turn them into stepping stones? Is it insecurity? Because the Lord wants to breathe life into you and make you secure in who you are and who you were made to be in Christ. It's okay to have vulnerability. You have to say, open up. The thing that set me free was saying, I am not all together. That's what freed me. People knew like the trigger that I had, but they thought I was a pretty nice person. I was a homecoming queen. I looked good on the outside, but my heart was dark. I thought dark things, but when the Lord came and breathed life into me and identity, I said, I no longer will stumble on the thoughts of other people or what man thinks about me, but I will say, God thinks this about me. And I turned it into a stepping stone. I'm going to get closer to the Lord. I'm not going to stumble backwards. I'm going to keep walking forward. What else is battling? What else are you battling with this morning? Is it something to do with how other people view you? Think about that for a second and say, Lord, what is holding me back from having an unhindered love? As a mom, it was trying to fit in with my kids of saying, I can do it all. But the more that I say, I can't do it all, the beauty I see that comes out of my kids. I can't do it. I get on my knee and say, oh man, guys, I shouldn't have just yelled at you. Please forgive me. And then they're like, way better. But when I say, do this, do this, do this, it's fake. We need the real stuff to return to the church. We need real love in our marriages. Why are worldly people going to come to know the Lord if our marriage is the same as theirs still? We have to be set apart. We have to say, you know what? We do fight. We fight over those same things. But we give them to the Lord. This is what marriage looks like in the Bible. And that's what we try to do. We're not perfect. We mess up all the time. Did you see us getting in the car the other day? I thought we should go to Ruby Tuesdays and he thought beefs and we just had a straight up fight. That's not a true story, but we probably do fight over food and we shouldn't. But those are little things compared to the big things. There are big things that we fight about in our marriages, but it's how we walk through them in love that will change people's hearts. So I'm going to hand it over to Jeremiah.
She's awesome. I have found a good thing. I hooked a brother up. So thankful for stable people. Talk to you guys a lot about PMS. So if you haven't heard me, I'll say it one more time. You know, prophetic people, they struggle with PMS, and it's not monthly, it's daily. It's called prophetic mood swing. So I'm constantly highs and lows, and you know, all the world will be saved and then they're all going to hell. And Morgan is just my rock and someone that I can stand on and look me in the eyes and say, you'll be okay. And I'm so grateful for her. And she stalked me so long on campus, I just gave in. Okay. So I'm just going to talk just for a few minutes kind of about where I was coming from in our relationship. And I have a little sheet for you just to take home. And it's about self-protection. I don't know if you've ever heard of this word, self-protection, or maybe have you ever tried to love someone and it felt like there was a hand in the middle of you all? I knew this was going to happen. Everybody's going to get the sheet and read it, not listen to me. They don't have it yet. But I'm just going to be vulnerable in front of you and talk a little bit about my story. But I've realized over the years about myself and about other people that, you know, sometimes it's hard to love people. Because they have all these walls that they put up. And working with married couples, I was counseling a couple a few years ago that had been married about 40 years. And I asked the woman, about what percent of your husband do you really know? And she said 20%. And I want to talk a little bit about the ways that we keep who we really are from other people. And I would refer to myself as a master self-protector. Many of you might not realize that about me, and you can read on your sheet there 60 different forms of the way that we keep people out of our space. And again, I'm talking about people that have been married all these years as well, let alone some of you that aren't married yet. So I was the kid in high school that did sports 24/7. I was a wrestler since the time I was 4 years old. I was a state runner-up and a state placer in Indiana. They called me a mat rat. I had surgery on my ears, cauliflower ear, the whole thing. We'd wrestle in season, wrestle out of season, and that was kind of my excuse for why I didn't have a girlfriend. Morgan Dilly was actually my first girlfriend. When I brought her home to my house, my youngest brother said, "Thank God you're not gay." Is it all right to be funny?
Yeah.
Some of you are like, come on, people. But sports was kind of my way of hiding from my fears, hiding from all the excuses and all the reasons why I couldn't be loved. How many people in here have done something in the past that you'd rather no one know about? There's shame and there's condemnation and there's guilt that we all carry around. But obviously, thank God for the blood of Jesus that washes us clean and that renews us. There is freedom and there is hope. But I remember the first time I met Morgan, honestly, and I know these guys in here are going to think, oh, he's just trying to get brownie points and you know, all these different things. But honestly, when I met her, I thought she was, I guess, she was so beautiful. I want to just say hot, but I don't really want to offend people. But I thought she was so beautiful, I thought, there's no way. And so I just kind of, you know, went around and gave myself into some different pursuits and things. And we got in a group of friends, and I was leading a prayer group at Southeastern. We would pray all night. We'd see baptisms in the Holy Ghost, physical healings, prophecy, all these different things, just kind of throwing myself into ministry at that point. And the Lord really began to get a hold of my heart and really begin to deal with a lot of my insecurities and a lot of my walls and a lot of the ways, you know, if you look on your list there, you know, number four was kind of my go-to. Spiritualization is a great way to keep people out. Christians are masters at that. I'm fine by the grace of God, refusing to deal with realities by spiritualizing them away. I'm not sick, weak, or hurt. I'm healed. You know, you have Christians use this phrase all the time. Well, it's under the blood. You know, and my thing is, it's not really in the past unless it stops affecting the present and the future. Hello.
Yeah.
All these, oh, it was a part of my past. I've been freed now. I've been distanced away from that. But why is it still affecting your current relationships? If you're so over, let's say, somebody molesting us when we were 8 or 9 years old, if I'm over it and it's under the blood, why am I still trying to keep people that love me out of that little room in my heart? Because that's the way that I look at love and relationships. All of us have these rooms and these doors inside of our person, and we're on a journey trying to decide who we're going to let in and who we're not. And the tragedy is some of us are still married and for years, and those doors are still closed. So I remember when Morgan and I started dating, I literally, Emery, it was like revelation. I was sitting in the Casa Cafe, and it was like, I remember the day the Lord opened up my eyes that she was the one. It was like, I'd seen her before, but she walked in this long sleeved turquoise shirt with a brown vest, and I just thought, oh God, I might be able to love somebody, but I don't know if I can be loved. Because we all want to know and be known. We all want to love and be loved. There's something inside of every person in this room that cries out, if they really knew X, Y, and Z, would they still love me? See, I'm not really a fan of this premarital counseling stuff where you just don't talk about anything in the past. Like, oh well, we're good now, moving forward. And it's just a matter of months and years before that porn addiction comes back to bite you. Before those undealt issues of the heart come back and they get you. And so one of the things that the Lord began to talk to me about is the difference between deep and intimate relationships versus shallow and dysfunctional relationships. Began to talk to me about the difference between deep and intimate relationships and shallow and dysfunctional relationships. So for deep and intimate relationships, there's really two requirements. There's two rules. Number one, vulnerability. And number two, trust. I read the book of Acts. Now I'm just talking about a community. And one of the things that excites me about what we read in the book of Acts is that they actually had intimate communion with one another. They were of one mind and of one heart. They were on the same page. They knew how to take care of one another's needs because they knew what they were. There are people in this room right now struggling, and you couldn't help them if you tried, because we won't take time to actually ask them what's going on. And so the first requirement, vulnerability, how many people have heard this word? I wonder if we know what it really means. Are you ready? I'll give it to you real simply. Capable of being wounded. Capable of being wounded. And again, this is the scary thing when you're in that dating season, or even when you get married. If I begin to open up the doors and the windows into my person, all of who I am, I love the Song of Solomon. I am my beloved's and they are mine. Like, all of me, I give you. When I say I do at the altar, I'm giving you permission to unlock every door of my heart. Because what I love about the nature of God, He is always self-disclosing Himself to us. But humanity, because of our shame and guilt and condemnation, we're always self-protecting. The Bible says, as deep cries out to deep, I'm hoping that the deep part of me will call forth the deep part of others. The truth is this: if only shallow people are hanging around me, that probably means I'm shallow. You can do this all the time, you know, like small talk, especially we love doing this at church, you know, how you doing, and what do you do for a living, what happened this week, and it's like you just keep it small talk, you keep it shallow, and hope that they'll give you a shallow answer. But then when you get to the heart of the matter and you actually ask them about stuff that really matters in life, if they don't give you a deep answer, that's kind of like a sign of like, I'm moving on. I mean, what type of love and relationship are we creating in this community? Are we comfortable enough with one another that we could go in the back or come up front and have a real life conversation about what we're really struggling with? And again, the elephant in the room is some of us can't even do this in our marriage. So it's okay if this word vulnerability is scary. But it's the place that God is calling us to if we're going to have healthy in deep relationships. People's stuff or their junk was never meant to be information, or I should say was never meant to be ammunition used against them. People's stuff and their junk should be information on how to pray for them.
Amen.
I want to be a safe place. I hope the goal for you and I as believers in Jesus Christ is we can be a safe place for really people to come and vomit on us. Okay, you guys are holy. You've never vomited on anybody. I want to put out those vibes. I want to put out those. I'm a place where we can get deep and vulnerable. I'm willing to get vulnerable. I'm willing to be capable of being wounded because I'm connected to the healer. I'm willing to cry with other people. This is the sign of Christian maturity. It's not necessarily rejoicing when people rejoice, but it's mourning when they mourn. It's bearing one another's burdens. Like, I can't tell you, this morning up at the altar, this was the New Testament church. This was people real, struggling, hurting, people getting around them and the Spirit of God moving all around us. That's what Jesus died for. He didn't die for 3 songs and a nice message, and we'll see you next Sunday. But if we're going to go for deep, we were talking about this at Bible study on Wednesday night in the Connect Room. What would it look like if Heart of the Father Ministry gave themselves to deep and intimate relationship and we were known as a safe place in Lakeland? Just with real people that didn't put on the nice clothes and, you know, your marriage is going down the tube and you just, oh, praise the Lord, hallelujah. I want to be a place where people, the music hasn't started and they're down at the altar weeping. You know us here, I'm not interested in, that's a good thing, I'm not interested in church. I'd rather go work at McDonald's. I tell our staff, I would rather go do anything else than just practice religion, go through the motions. The Spirit of God is really not at work in our midst. The Lord Jesus, He died for this and He's drawing us into this. So vulnerability, I want to encourage you, talking about love and relationship, get vulnerable with the people that you love. Now, I always have to say this. It's like you have to say statements to say statements in America because the days that we're living in. But I'm not telling a young single female in here that the answer to your loneliness is to go vomit all of your real deal stuff to any young men that will listen. Okay, I think that it's wit and people really do this stuff. You see, never mind, another message. Find safe places. How many of you have, I don't even want to say friends or marriage, how many of you have friends that are safe places that you can actually go to? Here's my desire. I pray they're in this room. I pray that they're in this room. Vulnerability, we're almost done. Trust. Deep and intimate relationships require vulnerability and trust. Confidence placed in a person. We're learning how to trust one another. We're learning how to get vulnerable with one another. We're learning to open up all the doors of the windows of our hearts. To me, this whole thing about deep and intimate relationship, the password to get in is called intimacy. And to break it down for people, maybe you've heard this before, the easiest way to break down what intimate relationships look like is simply this. Into me you see. Into me you see. Being in intimate relationships with one another is that someone has allowed you to peer deeply into who they really are and you're not afraid by what you see. How we doing? Is anybody in any intimate relationships? The Bible makes the connection. How can you claim to love God and not love others? Maybe we need to go back to step one. Here's step one. I'm in an intimate relationship with God. There's nothing I hide. Why hide? He knows every hair in my head. I've never understood this as a Christian, why people try to hide their sin. He knows, just confess. It's good for you. It's not good for him. It brings refreshing. It brings healing. But part of walking as a believer, working out our sanctification with fear and trembling, is, Lord, I open up every door. I expose every lie of the enemy. I'm coming bare, naked before you. Here I am, God. And in that same intimate love relationship that I have with God, that's the way I relate to other people. You know, I meet people all the time. They claim to have a really deep relationship with God, and they have no intimate relationships with people. Can I tell you, that doesn't add up? This whole, a lot of it happens with intercessory people or prophetic people. It's like, again, let's go back to forms of self-protection. We're so spiritual and we're so connected with God that I don't have time for other people. Can I just assure you, Jesus would give you a quick thumbs down? No, the manifestation that you have a deep love with God is revealed in deep relationships with people. You can't claim to have an intimate relationship with God if you do not have intimate relationships with people around you. So we've got one of two choices. We can jump into this deep and vulnerable, and remember walking through the dating process and finally stopping all the excuses, stopping all the forms of self-protection, and found a woman who wasn't afraid of who I really was. I braved one of my fears of heights, and I blindfolded her. She was an RA at Southeastern, and it was her birthday, August 24th, and I decided to propose to her up in a hot air balloon. Now, when I get nervous, my hands sweat. So I showed up on campus, I knocked on her door, I blindfolded her, and I said, hey, I've got a surprise for your birthday. So we went over to Tampa for a sunrise hot air balloon ride. And we get out there and we get up in the air and I'm like shaking. You know, who's been in a hot air balloon ride? But a really awkward experience, especially if you're going to propose. Because it's you and, you know, your girl and like the guy doing the scream for you. And the basket was way smaller and the balloon was way bigger than I literally felt like I was going to throw up. And so I get down on one knee and I'm so nervous, I pull the ring. And of course, we were so poor that the diamond that she has on her ring was her mom's. You know, Morgan always jokes, she goes and gets her nails done in the salons and they say, oh, your husband, he's so rich, you know, and really was like, no, that's my mom's ring. So I just got the band, but I was so nervous, the ring fell out of my pocket and was this close from dropping out of the balloon. And, you know, so I get down on one knee and I'd written a poem, and the poem was really about, thank you for loving a guy like me. You know, you provided a safe place for me to, I know this is like getting gushy, but we need this. Who's not married in here? This is who you need to find.
Come on.
Do not engage in fake and patron of all.
Yeah.
Find somebody that's real. Maybe they're not your dream model and they're not as attractive as you thought they were, blah, 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 whatever. Never mind, I won't say that. Find somebody that you can. I pray this over people. I pray over their spouses. I pray for friends. I pray that God would give each and every one of us friends. I had some random guy text me yesterday and said, man, I love you and I don't really care about the prophecy stuff. And I said, brother, let me tell you something. You're about one of three people that have ever said that to me in my life. I said, to most people, I'm just a vending machine that they put a quarter in to get a word from God, and no one ever looks to see what's inside the vending machine. Like, I love you for you. I tell Morgan this all the time, like, yeah, you know, as a guy, she's hot, and you think she's sexy, and you're all about it early on in marriage or whatever, but I'm like, here's the revelation I've had. I actually love you for you. Like, you as a person, you get my engines revved. I love the person that you've become. I hope that we have relationships in this room, that the love that we have for one another is not about what we do for one another. Are we falling in love with the person that we married, or are we falling in love with the friends that we have, even though they're different? Where was I? Yeah, good, good, let's finish it. So she said yes. I always say she kissed me more that day than the whole marriage. Dude, I mean, these hot air balloon rides are scary. When we're landing and the guy starts running, chasing the basket, I'm like, what is going on? We're like ready for a crash landing here. So we land, and you know, we ended up, you know, I took her to this breakfast cafe in Tampa, and I had secretly flown her dad in because they have a really good relationship. And I said, you know, who's the one person you would want to spend this day with besides me, of course? She said, my dad. And I had my buddy from Southeastern bring him right in, and it was all good. And we got married up in Ohio. We had such a great relationship with Southeastern. We literally had over 40 kids from Southeastern drive up on their spring break and spend it with us. We got married spring break of our senior year at Southeastern. So the password is intimacy. 1 Peter 4:8, love one another deeply. I love that. I love it just doesn't say love one another. It says love one another deeply. And again, when we talk about deep and intimate relationships, it requires trust and vulnerability. I pray that the Lord would give us a spouse where we can go there, we can lay our hair down, we can get real. I pray that He'd give us friends, He'd give us mothers and fathers and aunts and uncles where we can be safe. I want to be a safe place. And then finally, I'll just finish with shallow and dysfunctional relationships. We can do the deep and intimate thing, or we can do shallow and dysfunctional. Here's my definition of dysfunctional relationships. It's a great revelation. Are you ready? A dysfunctional relationship is this. Something happens and you act like it never happened. Have you ever met these people? You're one and I'm one. Like, you do something wrong, you make a mistake. I know a guy, and he'll just like flat out go off on you, yell, scream. And it's like the next day he acts like that never happened. Oh, how you doing, buddy? I'm like, dude, I'm not doing dysfunctional relationships. We do this in our marriages. We play the one-up game. You did something stupid, so you buy her flowers because that's her love language, but the heart of the matter never got addressed. We never had a sit down and navigated through, this is the real issue that I'm working with. This is the, Morgan said earlier, the heart of the matter. And I would encourage you, do not engage in dysfunctional relationships. And if you're married in one, get help. Refuse to go another day without getting issues out on the table, swallowing our pride and saying, we need help. I'm so thankful for a couple like Barry and Diane Nichols, who woke Morgan and I up to the reality of what it means to discipline your children. We desperately needed help when they were younger, and they probably don't know this, but that we look up to them. They've helped us. They've walked us through, and there are people around you even right now. And you know, this is where the scripture, like, you know, you hate these people that won't let it go, right? Because we all just want to keep going. You know, dysfunctional relationships are all about sweeping it under the rug. I tell people, don't sweep it under the rug, put it under the blood.
Yeah.
All right, I know I'm really meddling now. Some of you are like, oh boy, I can't wait till we get in the car on the way home. And Jeremiah said, so let's go. You get your sword out, and I'll get my sword out, and we'll see who wins. So where there's deep and intimate relationship, the two ground rules are vulnerability and trust. The password is intimacy. If we're going to do shallow and dysfunctional relationships, the two rules are, number one, sweep everything under the rug, and number two, keep information close. Never divulge how you're really feeling for fear that you're going to hurt their feelings. So you're protecting their feelings by trying not to hurt their feelings, and really you're hurting your own feelings. It's a mess. The password for shallow and dysfunctional relationships is called look the other way. Just act like it didn't happen. Time heals all wounds. Can I tell you that's a bunch of baloney? Time does not heal all wounds. Here, I'll give you a biblical truth. Jesus heals all wounds. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, you didn't hear me. Jesus Christ heals all wounds. Now, yes, time can be an indicator in that matter, but Jesus Christ heals all wounds. So this type of love and relationship that we're going after, I say we're going after this and as a community, a part of the Father. I believe that if you could create a community based on vulnerability and trust, there's no telling what the Holy Spirit could do in your midst. There's no telling what kind of friends and God and relationships God could give you if we became a safe place. But what I'm sensing in this room right now is some of us need to go back to square one and get vulnerable and learn how to trust God again. He has our life in the palm of His hands. He is good. He is never going to let us down. I always encourage people, when you sing that, just make sure your will is His. There's a lot of people in the kingdom of God get let down because their dreams weren't God's dream. I always want to insert scripture into songs. Like, oh Lord, someone's down at the altar and they're dreaming whatever they're dreaming, and He's never going to let me down. Yes, He is. Because He cares more about your heart than you becoming a millionaire. Okay, I'm getting off track. All right, let's close our eyes. Honey, will you come up? Father, we thank You for this morning. We thank You for the opportunity to talk about love and relationships. And Lord, we thank You for what Morgan shared. We thank You for what You've put on my heart to share. And Holy Spirit, we just invite You here right now. God, I sense that You want to heal some of us from emotional wounding. Some of us that have been in abusive relationships where getting vulnerable and learning how to trust became something that we would never do. I really feel that the Lord is calling on fathers in this room right now. This is a prophetic word that the Lord just gave me. That there are men in this room where you were never given permission to be vulnerable with your own earthly father. And the Lord wants to teach you how to now be vulnerable with your own children. I sense that the Lord is saying to some fathers in here that you will not walk in the ways of your father. Where they were secretive, they were aloof, they were away, they weren't there, they were abusive. You will break the cycle as you're led by my Spirit. If that's you and your father in here, and you sense that's for you or could be for you, I want you to come down to the altar right now. Just really sense that the Lord could be calling on a few fathers in this room to a new level of trust and vulnerability with your children. I was reading last night the biography of Leonard Ravenhill, and he was talking about William Booth and the work that he did for the Salvation Army. There was two women that wrote in that were tired and had given their all and said, "We need you to send us somewhere else. We can't complete the work." And he sent them a telegraph that said, "Try tears." Be some of the most successful missionaries he ever had. I feel led to pray for the gift of tears and emotions over the men that are standing here. That the Lord would give you an emotional connection with your children. That dad crying and weeping and showing emotions would be normal. So would you all just stretch out your hands and give. Father, we thank you for every father that's up in this altar right now. And God, we ask in the name of Jesus that you would flood their mind and their heart with your emotions. God, we pray for the gift of tears to be released. We pray for soft hearts, for tenderness like never before. But we pray for tender-hearted fathers to be raised up from this house that would produce tender-hearted children. Thank you that a kind answer turns away wrath. I just feel like the Lord is saying that your children are watching how you respond to the hardships in life. Your children are watching how you respond to those that give you a hard word. This is about breaking cycles and leaving a legacy to your children. I just see a forest of trees being cut down. You're blazing a path for your offspring. Prophesy over some father in here, a reconnection is coming this year that you lost with your son or daughter last year. The Lord is going to open up the lines of communication. Humility goes a long way.
That you know who you are God. you're struggling in your identity, will you just lift your hands to the Lord as I pray? God, we just thank you for your love this morning. We thank you, God, for creating us. I feel like there's somebody in here that doesn't even know why you were created, but God thought you out. He knows your name. Every hair on your head is accounted for. You were made fearfully and wonderfully, and by his grace, you are saved. Receive his love this morning. Sons and daughters of the King, everyone in here, you were bought with a price. Oh Lord, grip our hearts to know you more, because in knowing you more, we know who we are. God, we love you. Show us who you are. Every day of my life, I can find out something new about you. That's the beautiful thing about you. Lord, we obey you because we love you. If you love him, you'll obey his commands, and it'll be easy. Because why would you want to hurt your father's heart? God, we love you this morning. Angry at the enemy, the people not knowing who they are in him. Jesus, this morning, grip hearts in Jesus' name.
Can we all stand? Father, we thank you.